Is ProstRcision a good method for a combination therapy with seeds and EBRT? And so first of all, can you explain what EBRT is and then how this would combine those?
So Radiotherapy Clinics of Georgia, founded by Dr. Kritz more than 20 years ago, has pushed aggressively the use of combination seed implants plus external beam radiation therapy, that's EBRT. In my opinion, they've been right. They have their own proprietary trademark for this combination of giving external beam radiation plus seed implants called ProstRcision. But seed implants and external beam radiation therapy are available anywhere. No one else calls it ProstRcision. So it's just a trade name that they've coined. It is a good approach. My only complaints with the Radiotherapy Clinics of Georgia is it's sort of a one-size-fits-all. Seems like if you're intermediate risk, you get the same treatment. If you're high risk, you get the same treatment. And the combination of external beam radiation plus seed implants is effective, but probably should be reserved for the people with high risk. And the people with intermediate risk can just have a seed implant without any external beam radiation. So I don't believe that everyone needs to be treated that aggressively. But if someone has high-risk disease, ProstRcision, if you want to call it that, but really it's just a combination of beam radiation plus seed implants, is indeed the best way to go.
So our next question is, will Lutetium-177 be extended, as far as the stage goes, to castrate-sensitive patients? And is there any interest in using it in any other stages currently?
So Novartis bought Lutetium-177 for a couple billion dollars, and a couple months ago came out and said that the large trial that's being performed to prove its capacity to extend life was positive. In other words, that it established that lutetium is effective, and it's going to be probably on the market in the next year or two. This was for men with advanced stage disease that had already had chemotherapy, and it's wonderful that it works. And we know that a lot of times treatments that are effective in advanced disease will be more effective at earlier stages, for example, hormone sensitive disease like the questioner is proposing here. There have been some limited studies done, small trials showing that, to no one's surprise, that there is the patients do achieve responses when they're hormone sensitive with lutetium, patients that have metastatic disease. And so I think it will be popular in that setting. The next question, of course, in the back of everyone's mind is, would it be effective in people that had rising PSA levels after surgery? We know that a certain percentage of those people have cancer where the prostate used to be, and you can radiate it with beam radiation and cure a significant proportion. But what about people that have small specks of cancer somewhere else in the body? Will we be able to inject lutetium and eradicate those microscopic specks? This is a complete unknown. And of course, we don't know, would that degree of radiation exposure throughout the body with lutetium, would that become dangerous after 5, 10, 15 years? There are a lot of unanswered questions, but it's exciting that we have this brand new tool.
So our next person is asking a question regarding chemotherapy, and they want to know how effective icing fingernails, mouth, and scalp are during that chemotherapy process, because they want to know if there are certain situations they should do it and certain situations they shouldn't.
It's almost universally effective. There's really no situation that we wouldn't do it. Fingertips is because all the fast-growing portions of the body are more susceptible to chemotherapy side effects, your hair, your fingernails. And so the simple idea is that if you make these areas of the body cold, the blood flow is reduced. And so when men are having the chemotherapy circulate in their bloodstream, which is only for about an hour, that if you keep ice chips in your mouth, for example, it shunts blood away from your tongue so that your sensitive taste buds are not impacted by the chemotherapy. People that don't do that will notice that food kind of tastes bad, that the taste buds are affected by the chemotherapy. And ice is a simple way to minimize those side effects.
Does it work in all types of chemotherapy, like taxane or anything else, or does it only for prostate chemotherapies, for instance?
It's been so long since we've used anything but taxanes. So with breast cancer, they use ice caps to prevent blood flow to the scalp so that women who are undergoing therapy don't lose their hair. So I think it's a pretty popular approach for other types of cancer.
This person was recently diagnosed with intermediate prostate cancer, and they say that they understand that removing the prostate would certainly fix flow issues. And I think they're talking about urinary flow issues. And they also understand that radiation treatment, there may be some short-term increase of urinary flow issues. But long-term, does radiation treatment for prostate cancer resolve flow issues from BPH?
Sometimes it does. The radiation over a period of 1 to 2 years will cause some reduction in the size of the gland, and men can have improvements in urinary function. It can go the other way, too. Some men can develop chronic irritation of the urethral passage, which can exacerbate urinary flow problems. So, and of course, with surgery, yes, it can sometimes alleviate flow problems by removing the gland, but of course, it can also instigate problems with incontinence where you're leaking constantly. So, these treatments for cancer, I typically don't position them as fixes for urinary problems. I see that as a separate issue. And I would not be attracted to doing surgery or radiation, except under the most rare circumstances. Because of its impact on the urinary function, I'd be looking at the global picture of cure rates, urinary function, overall quality of life, not just one narrow aspect, as is being proposed in this question.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to our YouTube channel for new prostate cancer videos every week, and visit our website, pcri.org, because we have all sorts of prostate cancer information that can help you. We hope you have a great week.